Welcome to Event Radio, covering local drag racing, stock car racing, motorcycles, go-karts. If it's got wheels and you can race it, you'll hear about it here. Event Radio is motorsports radio on steroids. Now, let's join your hosts, Spivvy Williams and Terrible Tea Guy.
All right, guys, welcome to the next edition of Event Radio. We are in motorcycle flat track country. We are in Lebanon, Tennessee at the Vintage Flat Track event that we just absolutely love coming to every year. It's down here at the same place that they hold the Redneck Rumble.
Wilson County Fairgrounds.
Wilson County Fairgrounds. And, man, they've got some heavy hitter bike guys here.
Got some top-notch riders, too.
Yes, sir.
And modern.
Yes, sir. We're going to
and I see a rat rod coming by.
Oh, yeah. They got cars. They got all kinds of cool stuff. But we're going to get to introduce you today to some of the really, really hot dogs of the motorcycle race scene. Terry, this ought to be right in your element.
These are your guys.
We don't
have a lot of pictures behind these. I've done seen a 1953 Norton Speedway bike. I didn't know such a thing existed.
Well, yeah, you told me that. I wasn't sure of ever seeing anything like that. And
I guess that's why it's got a crowd around it. But
It does.
That's a piece of history there.
All three of the bikes that it's next to, it's got an old BSA and it's got
an Indian,
and they all have cards in front of them that explain the history and that stuff. This is a really fun motorcycle event, guys. If you want to come down here, it's done the end of October. Yeah, this is the fifth annual. It's done the end of October every year. And, of course, any event that Scooter does is a killer.
Both Brothers Promotion just doesn't do anything wrong.
No, they really don't.
They really don't.
That, and a nice facility, nice bathrooms, which is important if you bring your
girlfriend. People can tell we're getting old when we start talking about the bathrooms at all the different events.
Yeah, but that's really important if you bring your wife or your girlfriend. They,
more
you
important
know,
for me.
Well, I don't know. We can sometimes get by behind a tree, but they need a little help sometimes. And they really have nice facilities here for everything that they have going on. They even have good food and a concession stand, you know. And of course, Scooter is the event promoter extraordinaire.
Well, Spiv, it's like any motorcycle event. You see some fast bikes and hot women.
Well, yeah.
I mean, you know, Ray Charles would say that lady over there is attractive.
Well, what's the deal? You've been around motorcycles your whole life. You've been racing them everywhere in the country. What is the deal with good-looking girls always hanging out with the motorcycles? Why? What's the deal there?
You know, I really don't know. It's sure not because we're making that much money racing. And maybe it's just the camaraderie, the excitement, the traveling.
But they can do that in a lot of other stuff, you know. And the motorcycles are always attract the pretty girls. I don't understand. You know about it, but I don't, you know. I wish I knew the secret. Well, we're going to have a lot of fun here today, guys. We're going to get to introduce you to a lot of people, some that you have talked to, some that you – this will be the first time to talk to them because they've actually blended this race in with some a little bit of a car show, in with
– swap meet.
A swap meet. There's all kinds of really cool stuff. And we passed one motorcycle that this thing is absolutely outrageous.
I don't know what that motor was off of, but I think Columbus might have used it somewhere on.
Yeah, the whole thing, it's a rat rod motorcycle, and we're going to take pictures of it. And it was sitting there running, and it's sort of like it hits about every fourth time. It sounded like an old washing machine motor or something on. I don't know.
I was afraid to drive by it, much less ride it.
Afraid to pitch a rod out and go through the side of the truck, huh? But anyway, we're going to have a lot of fun today. We're going to introduce you to a lot of people. And, you know, let's get with it and have some good time. What do you think?
I tell you what, anyone who loves motorcycles needs to come to this event.
Well, yeah, it's a good one. I look forward to this one every year. It's just a neat one.
Well, our
deal.
Ratings last year's show was really high on this.
Oh, listen, we have a tremendous amount of followers in this show, and we get to see a lot of old friends and make some new friends, you know. And it's just cool. We've got a what is that thing? Is that a whizzer?
That's a whizzer.
Oh, wow. There's
that's,
everything
that's
here.
That's not the Chinese yeah, repop.
That's
the real deal.
That's the real deal. Yeah, that's for sure. All right, guys, we're going to take a real quick break, say hi to our sponsors, and we're going to get real busy real quick with our guest from the Vintage Flat Track Racing in Lebanon, Tennessee. Don't you go anywhere. You're on Event Radio, and we will be right back.
Right back.
All right, guys, we are back with our first victim from the Vintage Motor, or excuse me, Flat Track Races in Lebanon, Tennessee. I'll come
well,
awake
that's
here.
Vintage Flat Track.
Yeah, I'll get awake here in a little bit. I'm just a little slow and old and fat and stuff, and that works, you know. But we have our first guest, and the microphone and all is very, very friendly to him because he does it all the time. Mr. Kevin Lynn, how are you, sir?
I'm doing great.
Yeah, and you look like you're having fun out there. That boy, the fun police will get you.
Yeah, we had a little trouble getting here. Made about 9 U-turns, but we're here.
You got the same GPS we got.
Yeah, that's contradicting ourselves all the
way
here.
Boy, I tell you what, ours says, you put the thing in, she said, I ain't got a clue.
I about threw her out the window a few times and dragged her by the cord.
Ah, that's just take her, put her on the bike and take her for a ride. There you go.
Well, Kevin, what are you riding here today?
Well, riding the Suzuki.
All right.
RM450Z.
Oh, one of them bad boys.
Yeah, the RMZ. I got so many of them here, I can't tell
you. Well, I've seen that 22 is just about half of them here, so you take your pick, huh?
Yeah. I got Chris Boone going to ride my vintage 500 bike in the money class.
Well, I'd say that'd be a pretty safe bet.
Yeah, got my money on him.
Are you saying he comes with a bank deposit slip? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, well, I tell you what, it's good when you got a rider that you feel that confident about, you know.
Yeah, he's all right.
Well, he's a good rider. I seen him down in, where was it, Huntsville we was running, or Decatur, and he was spanking everybody pretty good.
Yeah, he's old school. He raced the WKCRA races back in the day. He's pretty good.
Okay, good. Well, how's this new PR man photos coming out? You a man of many trades.
Well, it's going all right. It's I take a few pictures here and there and get a whole lot of likes on Facebook is about it. But
well, hey, that's a good deal. We've been fortunate on our little deal that Facebook is pretty friendly to us, and we actually use that to announce our upcoming shows, which is a new one every Monday.
Yeah.
So that's pretty cool. You know, I think photographers are neat guys. Because you're able, you can look right over there at that tree, and you see everything about that tree behind it. You know, and where Terry and I look at the tree, you see what I mean? But when you're used to capturing stuff on a picture, you look at the whole deal, you know?
It helps to be an amateur rider, too. You know what spots to get the good shots.
You know what's getting ready
to happen.
I'm
going to fall right here, right? But that's pretty cool. And another thing I think is really cool about photographers is you do something that nobody in the world can do. You stop time, you know. And if you think about that, that's pretty cool. You know,
a lot of people is don't care nothing about taking pictures anymore. It used to be a photographer every track, you know.
And that's a shame because you know, when you get old like Terry and I,
Terry's old.
Yeah, he is. He's a vintage. That's why we're at the vintage races, you know, and not the current.
Thank
deal.
You, Kevin.
Yeah, but you guys actually record the memories for us guys when we got old, and. At the time, and Terry and I have talked about this a lot, I raced alcohol funny cars. Of course, Terry was a motorcycle guy. And now we look back at those pictures, and we thought that, you know, we don't care about that photography crap. And now that's probably the most valuable thing we got because
don't
it's memories.
Show people prove we're not lying.
Well, right. but it brings back memories,
yeah,
you know.
I like looking at old pictures on Facebook. That's about all I do on there is look at old vintage motorcycle stuff.
Well, if you ever stop by the house on your next trip to Bowling Green, you're going to come out in the garage. You're going to get off on that now. It's
That's Pee-wee's Playhouse.
Yeah, Pee-wee's Playhouse on motorcycle.
I uploaded a bunch of Bobby Lewis's pictures. He took a lot of pictures back in the day, and some of his are on the internet now. So.
Well, you know, back when Earl and I was running novice like that, we was about the only drivers from Kentucky. You see in the program now. You know, Owensboro and Princeton, and
well,
they're putting out riders everywhere.
There was Dwayne Houghton back in the day.
Dwayne was bad.
He was from my hometown.
Good, bad. Yep.
I remember I heard of him, you know, and of course, all I did was follow and everything that I ever did, and even riding at night, a couple of Motard bikes that Hot Dog here has the one,
yeah.
And I had a beater. But I couldn't keep up with him. But it was at least fun. You know?
BMW beater.
Well, it was a beater. It wasn't fast enough. But other than that, you know, I've always been a huge motorcycle fan. I've never been really good on one, but I really liked them, you know. And I'm very envious to watch you guys out here. I think that's...
Actually, this here is the first place I raced.
Was it really?
Because I haven't been racing that long.
Yeah, I can remember Bebop was telling me when you started here. What's that been, 4 or 5 years ago, maybe, Kevin?
About 4 years ago. I think it was the second one he did here. Yeah.
Getting back to Dwayne, what's he still around? Him and his dad, or
Dwayne? His dad passed a few years ago.
Good fella.
Yeah, he's a good mechanic too. And now Dwayne working in coal mines.
Coal mines. Okay. Last time I seen Dwayne, he had made expert, had an XR riding into Louisville Downs, and that was the year that fool out of the crowd run
That's
in
right.
and hit
bad,
and
thing.
Davy Jones hit him and.
I've read stories on that.
Yeah, I was. This is no lie. I was within 10 foot of. We was in the infield there, and this guy just comes running across the track with a half pint in his hand, and Davey never got out of tuck position and hit him. You know, and it was a bad deal. But that's the last time I talked to Dwayne, and I've heard rumors that that's why Dwayne.
Yeah, pretty much. That's a gist.
Well, that would just about do it to anybody because they was pretty tight.
Sort of knocks the wind out of you.
Yeah, I would say so.
Well, yeah, and. You let one idiot like that, and you get – the press is terrible, even though we're part of it, you know, and we're terrible sometimes. But you covered – good news doesn't sell much, but the bad stuff, everybody
that's,
just hangs in line.
That's one thing I do not do is I do not take a picture of a down rider.
Well, now, somebody got me at – you probably seen it on Facebook, but I'm right flat on my back, knocked out, slick cold.
Yeah.
And that might be T's last ride. I don't know. I think it broke me from sucking
eggs.
Something
I do not do. I see that on there, and I don't like it.
Well, in this guy's defense, he apologized. He said, I normally don't do this, but being it's you, I'm going to do it for you.
Yeah.
did he find one with you 12 foot in the air backwards or
no,
something?
No, just on the ground, knocked slick out.
Yeah. Okay.
Kevin, how do people get a hold of you if they want to get a hold of your PR Man Photos?
Facebook.
Facebook?
I got a page on there. It's PR Man Photos.
Do you do pictures of everything or just bikes or what?
Mostly flat track, and I got a motocross track there in Dawson Springs that I take a lot of high flying photos of there. But
you doing any backflips yet?
No, sir.
Not on purpose, anyway.
No, I just take pictures of those guys.
Yeah, I don't understand all that deal, buddy. I don't think I couldn't do that. I don't believe.
Well, listen, we're gonna get off here. We appreciate you taking time.
Well,
to help us out here a little
bit. It's good
to
be here. I know Scooter is trying really hard here, and. I wish more people would support him.
Well, they can't blame the weather today.
No, they cannot.
No, it's a nice day.
I mean, it'd be a good day to get hung.
Well, I don't know about that. You know, I believe I'd want to at least go to concession stand first, you know, get a long ride.
Well, Kevin, we appreciate you coming, and good luck today. Give them a spanking. Give them old Kentucky spankings, these Tennessee boys.
We're going to try.
All right. Good luck, Chris, too. Not that you're going to need it.
Yeah.
All right, guys, welcome back to the flat track races from Lebanon, Tennessee. And we run up on a gentleman, this is not his first rodeo. What is your name, sir?
Jim Masters.
Jim, where are you from, my friend?
Galton, Tennessee.
Well, that's not very far.
No, that's the reason I'm here.
Oh, is it? Okay. But you told me you've done this quite a while.
Well, I started racing in 1956 and run a Daytona 200 in 1958. On an old machine I bought from Nashville. The guy that had a motorcycle shop in Nashville, it was a 45 Harley that he'd raced for years. And a friend of mine from Bowling Green, Harden Mays, was my...
Harden Mays.
He was my buddy. And we went to Daytona, and I ended up in the ocean. But I got to finish the race in 58.
Now, how in the world did you end up in the ocean? Tell us about that. I got to know about this deal.
I lost the chain.
Oh, you wasn't trying to go skinny dipping or nothing.
I went dead on into the last turn there, the far end of the track, and I lost the chain, wrapped it around my machine, and throwed it back in and dipped it out of a sink, and I ended up in the ocean. So we spent the night under the old lighthouse down there getting all the water out of it. And I got back on the track next day. So.
Yeah, but ain't them the memories that
they
are fun?
Me a water dog.
Oh, really? Did that name stick with you then?
The Tennessee water dog.
Well, yeah. Everywhere I go, the old boys are still living. They called me the water dog.
All right. Now you tell me, you raced with a fella that Terry's dad was big buddies with. a fellow by the name of Raymond McClard, and he was the Harley dealer in Bowling Green.
He was also the jailer.
Yeah, and had a and actually had a a parrot that cussed everybody. Oh, you remember that?
Yeah.
I can remember my dad, Jim, saying that Raymond, he was flagged with a beach bend on the motorcycle races, and that he would he had a sidecar on the side of this old Harley, and he would fill it up with ice and have it beer ice down for the after the races.
Yeah.
Raymond, kind of sounds like him, don't it?
Yes, sir. That's him. He used to give me all the old parts. He threw it away, and we made it happen with them old parts. You know, today you couldn't buy them for love and the money.
Well, no.
No, I tell you what, it's amazing. The internet, I think, has stepped up the old nostalgia stuff more than anything going, because it's exposed it to everybody in the world, you know.
Exactly right.
And if you had it back in a barn or something, there wouldn't be very many people other than two crazy picker guys that might show up. But boy, the internet just searches out and finds it. What do you do now, sir?
Well, I had a landscaping company for 15 years. I closed up. Prior to that, I was a bread man. I worked for Colonial Bread Company for 36 years. 15 years in landscaping, 6 years with the city of Gallatin. I mow all the right-of-way.
Really? That's cool. That's 70, all right.
77 years old. Still racing.
Yeah, still racing.
That's awesome. What class are you running in this week?
I'm just running Mad Dog here. We practiced yesterday at the fairgrounds. I put on a swap meet there yesterday.
Yeah.
Four. And Southgate and I, we practiced over there yesterday until about 5 o'clock.
The two most experienced men here, and they act like they need practice.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Now, how long you known old Charlie?
I rode a bicycle from Gallatin, Tennessee when I was 13 years old to get Charlie's daddy to weld it for me because I didn't have any money. So I met Charlie when he was on a tricycle.
Did you really? That's so you right. Guys been friends for a couple of days.
Well, we off and on, I've been knowing him probably 65 years.
Can you outrun him on a motorcycle?
No way, brother.
No way.
No way.
He rides a motorcycle like you'd ride a sidecar around the wall.
Well, when I first started racing, Southgate was already – had. Was expert. I mean, you know, he was like a grown-up then to me, and, he spanked me regular for a long time. And when I did beat Charlie, I was proud of that. Notice I said when I did, not that many times. But Charlie's kind of a legend around here like you, Jim.
Well, I'm not a legend, son. I'm a wannabe.
Well, you still are.
That's for sure. You ain't quit, my friend.
You're racing today. And
I ain't on quitting. I had a stroke 5 years ago, and 4 days later, I raced the motorcycle.
Well, all right.
Hey, now that's the way it ought to be done. Now, I'm telling you.
I'm not going to give up till I lay down. That's it.
Well, that's all right. There ain't nothing wrong with that.
I don't win nothing. I run DL, and everybody asked me one time, "What do you run DL for?" I said, "Dead last."
Yeah, but MF, most fun.
I'm still here, though.
There you go, my friend.
Hey, I tell you what, this is what makes the vintage race cool. Is to come and get to talk to guys like you that have lived it, that have been the record makers and record breakers their whole life. And like you said, running the Daytona 200, running all those cool things that you did, that's just awesome. That's wonderful.
We made it happen with stuff today that would cost a lot of money to buy, but then it was junk.
Well, that's okay. That's all right.
You make somebody else's junk is my treasure.
Did you ever run Beach Bend when it was a flat dirt track?
I was on that first race, in that first race.
Well, Terry's dad and two more guys are the reason that's there. They're the ones that laid out Beach Bend Raceway.
Yes,
and so you came to the first one, huh?
I was there at the first one. Charlie Garvin let us in free because it cost a dime, and he let me in free.
Well, you put on a show for him. He probably made.
I was putting on a show. I was young, but I was ready to go.
Well, what was it like? Let me ask you something. What was it like comparing racing back then to today? Can you even get it close?
I'm gonna be honest with you. There's nobody races today like they did then.
That's what I've always heard.
Tell me what's different.
What's different is they got more guts then than we got now.
Really?
They had less equipment to work
with. Right. Also, Jim, wasn't running narrow tires and no brakes?
Yes, sir. I never knew what a brake was till I had to race here five years ago. I didn't even have one.
That's why you was going so fast.
I couldn't afford the brake lines.
Well, I understand. But were they better then than they are now?
I would say we got some good racers across the nation, but I don't think none of them – none of them compared to the 50s and 60 boys that's out there.
Joe Leonard, Bart Markle.
We don't have that many races to run on, and they can't get as good as they was back then.
Okay, I understand. Well, you know, and sometimes technology is not a good thing. You know what I mean? I mean, when you start out doing it, it's sort of if it ain't broke, don't fix it, you know? Yeah. And you people fix a lot of stuff that really don't need fixing.
I opened up the fairgrounds in Galveston, Tennessee, 3 years ago, and we had our first flat track race there. Charlie Southgate's daddy was champion there in a sprint car that he built himself. And it's hanging in the ceiling right now in Indiana. Somebody bought it, but he's been trying to get it back. But back in those days, they didn't race motorcycles on that fairground. So 3 years ago, I decided to put one on. And this last year, we had one at the fair in June. We're going to have one Saturday night at the fair in June again this year.
Well, that'll be cool. That'll be deep.
Under the lights. And I've got three Hall of Famers going to be there to help me put it on. And
shoot, we might come down there and do a little radio with you.
Well, we was going to come this year, but we was already obligated, to go to Indiana.
Yeah.
So it'll be probably June 29th. I don't know, somewhere around that.
Well, we're going to give you a card, and if you'll send us an email, or if you don't fool with it, get
just
somebody
contact
to.
Contact me, Jim.
Yeah, or contact T and let us know. You know, we may try to work that out. We like doing new stuff, you know.
Well, if I could have you down to my fair race, you know, put on a show for us.
Hey, well, I tell you what, buddy. I don't know. You probably wouldn't want our show to see that, but this little thing, we actually can expose you to a lot of people. This little show goes all over the world. We've introduced you to a bunch of folks that you didn't know you that know you now, and that's pretty cool. You know, pretty neat.
I appreciate it very much.
Well, listen, my friend, we're going to cut you loose because you're going to have to go out here and play a while, and we can't stop you from playing.
That's
awful
words to hear. I've got to go play.
Yeah.
My wife didn't come with me, so I got to do my own thing here.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Listen, thank you so much for taking a minute to be on Event Radio. It has been our pleasure and our honor to have you join us and shed a little history with us that about the flat track racing and how cool it really
just
is.
Just to have a guest that raced the Daytona 200 on the beach is pretty doggone awesome.
Yeah.
They closed that track 2 years later after I run.
Well, it's because you run off the ocean. See, if you hadn't run off the ocean,
I've got a picture of it in my trailer I want you to see before you leave.
All right. Well, I want to see it. Guys, you're on Event Radio. We're having just too much fun.
Thank you, Jim. From the
Lebanon flat track races. And buddy, our guest probably will not be any better than who we just interviewed to you, but we're going to sure give it a shot. We'll be right back, guys. All right, guys, we are back from the vintage flat track races in Lebanon, Tennessee, and we are with a gentleman that if this was TV and not radio, we would not even have to introduce him.
Around this part of the country,
sir. When you look up flat track racing, this gentleman shows up in the encyclopedia.
Not only flat track, speedway,
everything. Mr. Charlie Southgate, how are you, sir?
I'm just fine.
You know, we had the pleasure of talking to you here last year, and you've probably been spanking them on a regular basis since then in the motorcycle racing. That's what you usually do, anyway.
Well, I hadn't been as many races this year as I did the last few years. My son got him a different job. Hadn't been able to. He hadn't showed up yet today. So
well, I noticed. I didn't see Boo around.
And he had to go back to work last night or this morning.
Well, he probably will show up.
He works in a machine shop in Gallatin, Tennessee, and they kind of rely on him a lot.
Well, isn't that sort of what you taught him? The trade you taught him? Because you're about as good as it gets in that business. You know, I had a friend one time that had a machine shop, and he was really good at what he did. And I said, well, what's the name of it? And he said, Precision Guesswork.
Yeah.
Now, our buddy over here told me to ask you about Bowling Green. He said to ask you about the Bowling Green races.
Which races now?
Now, I don't know. Jim, which races were I supposed to ask him about at Bowling Green?
Oh, I didn't know where he raced at Bowling Green.
I want to know if you raced there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I raced at raced at the fairgrounds there.
Oh,
did
yeah,
you?
We
yeah.
ran there a bunch
That's
of years, didn't we, Charlie?
Crooked finger at.
Did he cause that?
Uh-uh.
He didn't cause
Thanks,
that,
Charlie.
Half of Huntsville, Alabama caused that.
Oh, did
them Alabama boys?
Yeah, Alex Mitchell caused that.
Okay.
Alex Mitchell, he's the one that had my number. I had his number, actually, 79L.
Yeah.
And then after Alex quit, I got that. So I was always tickled that because he was quite the character.
Yeah. We started the This speedway racing is a bunch of heat races.
Okay.
And then they combine. You ride four or five times. It's, of course, sometimes you ride four and sometimes five, but they combine your points, and whoever's got the most points will win, wins the thing.
I see.
Well, my last ride at this one deal there, we started that thing four times. Alex would run into somebody and knock him all down. And so the last time, I'd get to start and start up the straightaway, and then when I get to the starting line, they'd red flag the race because Alex had knocked two or three down.
What is that? Maybe that's attrition. That's the way you're
Now, was that race in Bowling Green, Charlie, over at Lampkin Park?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, I was in that, heat 15, if I'm not mistaken. I think we all hit the ground two or three. I think I skinned your leathers up, matter of fact.
Yeah, well, I got away from it on the fourth restart. I got away from it and started down the back straight and went to make the turn, the left turn, and I couldn't turn. The bike was still going forward, and I had no control over it. And what it was, his motorcycle, the front wheel, had got jammed between my frame and the exhaust pipe.
Oh, well, that wasn't good.
It throwed him off, and when I went to lay into the corner, his bike was still trying to go straight.
Well,
it went down and ground the top off that knuckle right there. And the doctor fixed it, and then he went back, and it was okay, and then he got to messing with it and messed it up.
So. Well, sometimes, some people won't leave well enough alone with it. There you go.
Well, Charlie, you was a little different on the speedway tracks. You was running, what, a Gold Star BSA that
you built yourself? I had a Gold Star for two or three years, and then I started with my own frame that I made.
Right.
Then I bought a Jawa, and I let Ken Joyce ride the BSA, and he rode it for, I don't know, three or four years, and did real good with it.
Well, you did real good on that BSA when you was running.
Yeah.
We had quite a few good tussles there at Smyrna down in Huntsville. When you go to a racetrack and seen Charlie there, it was more like, you know, you better be racing for second because Charlie got them covered.
Well, you know, probably the everybody likes to see you, Charlie, but the people you got to race against, and they would just be just as happy if you'd stay home.
I remember the first time I seen you run was at Daytona at the old Memorial Stadium.
Yeah.
And I think you made third in the final that night.
Yeah.
I mean, that's, as my mama say, that's pooping in tall cotton right there.
Yeah, that was the two guys that was first and second in the speed in the 200 race the next day were in front of me.
The back when the road racers were running with the flat trackers, right. No kidding. Who was that, Charlie?
Dick Mann won the feature, and Romero was second, and I was third.
I tell you what, just being on the podium with them two is an honor.
Well, and both those guys were in that movie On Any Sunday.
Yeah.
Well, how come you wasn't in the movie? Were you out doing exotic dancing then or what?
I wasn't living in California.
No, is that what it was? I thought maybe that's when you started your exotic dancing career.
No.
That wasn't it? All right. Listen, my friend, it is always a pleasure to have you on the show.
Sure you is, are Charlie. Thank you so much.
Yeah, you are a wealth of experience on this, any kind of motorcycle racing. The name Charlie Southgate is known worldwide as being a shown up bad boy when it comes to bike racing, and it's an honor for us to have you on Event Radio. We really appreciate it.
Well, I appreciate it.
We're going to get out of here, guys. We're at the Vintage Flat Track Racing in Lebanon, Tennessee. We're going to have just a ton of fun. You're on Event Radio, and we will be right back. Guys, we are back from the Vintage Races in Lebanon, Tennessee, and the gentleman we're going to introduce you to is either a motorcycle genius or a mad scientist. I don't know which one it is. Maybe a little of both. But you have a Triumph 8 with two engines in it sitting side by side. What is your name, sir?
Yeah, my name is Ray Corlew.
Ray, where are you from?
Cottontown.
Cottontown, Tennessee.
It's Cottontown,
where in the world is that?
It's 10 miles west of Gallatin.
Okay, so it's not that far.
No, I'm
now. What in the world motivated you to put to take a Triumph motorcycle, which is a Bonneville with the two carburetors, I presume?
No, both engines are 1958 pre-unit engines.
Oh, okay.
And it was actually a TRC. They were two TR6 engines.
So they go through one transmission. Is that right?
One transmission. They have a direct coupling between the two engines.
And do you start them both with the Kickstarter?
With the Kickstarter. Now, I'm 71 years old, and I've got a buddy that's 35, and he starts it for me, and he's on the way over here, and we're going to crank it up here in a few minutes.
Buddy, I tell you what, I want to see it when you crank that dude
all
up.
Right.
I can't imagine. I had an old Bonneville, actually a 50-something model Triumph when I was a kid, And it was hard enough for me to start back then. I can imagine trying to do two at once.
Yeah, when I was 35, I could start it, but I can't anymore.
what possessed you to do that?
Well, I did not build this bike.
Okay.
And certainly don't want to take credit for it. But I saw it first at Daytona back in the 70s. Uh-huh. And it was built by a fellow by the name of Metal Flake Herb. That's what he goes by.
Okay.
And he built it, and he's a mad scientist or tramp nut or something.
Well, no, I mean, it's cool
now. He
wanted
to see if he could do it.
Yeah.
And he did, and I ran into him in June of this year at a bike show and asked him, I said, whatever happened to your old twin-engine tramp? And he said, well, it's in my living room. He lives down in Miami.
Yeah.
And
we got to move out of the way, but that's all right. We're still talking. That's cool.
Yeah, he said, I said, well, you need to get that thing out and show it where people can see it. And he said, oh, I'm not able to even push it around, much less start it. And
uh-huh.
So, and he said, let me sell it to you. So I wound up buying it.
Well, I tell you what, I'm a fairly old guy, and I've been around motorcycles since I was 5 years old. I have never even conceived of anything like that in my mind, much less thought I would see that, you know. But it's cool. I mean, it's really cool.
It is a cool bike. It looks cool. And it sounds wicked.
Oh, it's
and
got
we
to.
Crank it up here in just a little bit.
Well, I'm looking
for
forward
people
to
enjoy
that.
It. And I'm glad I was able to get it out of his living room. It'd been in storage since 1985.
Really?
And get it out and share it with
Did
people.
You redo it with the paint or anything? Or
no.
Was that the way it was?
That's the way it was, yeah.
It was just like that?
Just like that. I cleaned it up a little bit, put a new seat cover on. And
whatever.
We had to do, had to rebuild it. It runs off magnetos.
Yeah.
And it's got two Lucas magnetos. And you have to pull an engine to get to the magneto.
Uh-oh.
So
if it ever goes out of time, you're in trouble, right?
Well, it's just very time-consuming to work on it. But anyway, it hadn't ran since 1985. But we were able to get it running, and starts
Like I said, I've had the pleasure of seeing a lot of stuff. And I think that is
one of the most unique things I've seen.
It is. It is just so
cool.
Done
right.
Yeah.
Well, I hope folks will come out and take a look at it. And I'm just glad I was able to share it with people.
Yeah, there's a lot more here, guys, other than just racing to see. I mean, you walk through this pit area, and you will see some sure enough unique stuff. Now, is the Whizzer yours?
No, the Whizzer belongs to Dave Pruitt.
Oh, okay. So they're just sitting there close.
Yeah, they're just sitting there. Dave
they're being
buddies.
Buddies, just they're sitting there side by side.
Dave
is that
our
it?
Buddies, and so the bikes.
Our buddies, too.
Yeah, but I think it's the, far as I know, it's the only side-by-side twin-engine Triumph there is. There's several of the in-line dual-engine.
I'm surprised one of these museums like Barber or one of them hadn't tried to buy that from you because that is so unique. I've seen them. If you go to Nashville to the Pickers thing down there,
right.
They have a drag bike, and I think it's a BSA with them, too, that are in-line.
I believe it's a Norton.
Oh, is it Norton? Okay.
I think so.
Okay. But the motors are in-line, and there's several of those, even down to an old fellow by the name of Russ Collins that put 3750 Hondas on a drag bike, and the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe was the name of that one. But I have never seen them side by side, you know, and I think that's just so cool.
Yeah. Well, I did, too, when I first saw it and back in the 70s. I thought it was the coolest thing I'd ever seen.
I'm sure it's got a home.
Yes, it's got a home.
Got a home as long as you can, huh?
Yeah, I'm going to looking forward to taking it to different shows and sharing it with
folks. I hope we get to run into you again,
Alrighty.
You know, because it is really, really cool.
Well, thank you.
I've enjoyed it so much.
Right.
We're going to get off of here. You've been on Event Radio, guys. We're having just too much fun at Lebanon, Tennessee at the Flat Track Races. We will be right back. All right, guys, we are back from the Flat Track Races, Lebanon, Tennessee, and we run up on a guy. We just watched a heat race. And, buddy, this is not your first lap around
not
a motorcycle
your first rodeo.
Race, you know. Tell everybody who you are.
Yeah, I'm Chris Boone. I was national number 13 from 2000 to 2005, and used to do it for a living. I just do it for some fun and come out here to Lebanon and have a good time.
Well, buddy, we could sit in the stands, and we're not real smart, but we could tell that was not your first lap around the track.
Yeah, I've been riding since I was 5 years old. It's the only thing I know how to do, so I like to come out here.
Well, you learned how to do this pretty good.
Yeah, thank you very much.
You know, it's you put on a good show for the fans, and that's something T and I were talking about. The crowd is growing here. This has been this race has been a little hard to get off the ground. And the crowd is growing, and shows like you just put on, that'll bring them back.
I'd come back and see it.
Yeah, that'll bring them back.
I've seen Chris ride on the national circuit and also down in Alabama, too. So he's pretty quick on a motorbike.
Yeah, I like to put on a good show. I like to rip some big skids and make the little kids want to come do it, and makes our sport grow and makes it more popular for everybody.
Now you said that Mom is the number one sponsor. Now we're going to have to reach out and give her a little break here, where we can get you some cabbage coming in here somehow.
Yeah, no, we do good. I got enough. I got all I need to go, and we just need some tires here and there and the entry fee. But we got all that covered. Like I said, let's go have fun anymore. And She's spent enough money over the years. I've almost broke my mama over the years. So.
Well, trust me, she probably liked every minute of it.
Yeah, she has. Yeah, she's.
You know, that's part of being mom.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah, and she hardly even runs out on the track anymore when I crash.
Really?
Yeah.
She's used to seeing that.
She's
now?
She's kind of used to that.
Chris, who was the happiest when you got your national 13? Her or you?
I probably was. Probably I don't was. Know if she really knew how much it really meant. Right. But, it was a big deal for me when I made my first national.
Where did you get it at?
Indy Mile. I was running my first national. I won the semi there. Then I made that national at Joliet a couple weeks later, and at a half mile, then Peoria TT.
Wow.
Later that season, and so I've made five. I made every national, but a short track national, and so I was one spot out at Springfield one night, and kind of like to get that under my belt. But I think I'm getting a little too old now, maybe.
Nah.
Well, maybe not. Not the way you looked a while ago, Chris.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, you guys put on.
Thank you.
Y'all put on a good show.
Yeah,
I mean that's what the people come in here to see.
Good,
you
man.
Know, they come to see good, close, fast racing, and that's exactly what you gave them, and swap some leads. And
yeah, me and Denny Williams have been racing since I was probably 12 or 13 years old, and he's been always one of my favorite competitors, and it's really something to get to race with him again.
Yeah, well, it was a good show.
Thank
it really
you.
Was a good show.
Thank you.
Out of all the races you've run, and being the pro, you were, like you say, doing it for a living, and now it's back to being fun. And is that a big change?
Yeah, it's a lot more fun. Not that I didn't. I never was one to put a lot of pressure on myself, really. But you kind of got to when you pull up and there's this guy with a semi there with two $30,000 XR750 sitting there for you to race. And, you know, you almost got to go do good that day. Or it's hard to roll back in the pits after you.
A little bit of intimidation.
Yeah,
factor,
a little
you know?
Intimidation when you line up with the best guys in the world and you're kind of looking down the line there and you're kind of thinking, man, do I belong out here with these guys? And
well, evidently you did.
Yeah, we had a good career.
Well, it's there are a lot of guys that use that intimidation factor that really just ain't that good.
Exactly.
They're good at sweet talking sponsors and getting the money to do it with, and then that's where it sort of stops.
Yeah, exactly.
And but you go out there and actually show them that, hey, with a big check, I'm gonna show you how to earn it, you know, and that's pretty cool.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I try to go out and do my best every time for sure.
So you're having fun here, huh?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. We get a good crowd of people here. Good show. Got some cool cars here to look at, cool old motorcycles. And
I know the Scooter was asking you to help a little bit on the track maintenance.
Yeah, and we're doing track maintenance, too. We're
looking
using
better.
My truck for the track maintenance, so we got a little moisture in it. And
It's mandatory to fill the truck up with gas after you use it.
I think so.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, I've been trying to get a free tank of gas out of the deal.
There you go. Hey, got to go where you can go, my friend.
Yeah.
Listen, we appreciate you taking a couple of minutes. You just came off the track. And we felt a little bad about coming to get you, right that quick. But we're trying to get this wound up while it's quiet out there.
Yeah, exactly. And I'd like to thank Kevin Lynn today for my vintage bike ride and riding the old style Honda. That's probably almost as old as I am. I think it's a 78 model. I'm a 75 model myself, so we're pretty close to the same age.
Well, I don't think you probably could do that good on it at 3 years old, could you?
Yeah, probably not.
Probably not. Okay. Listen, thank you so much
for
being on Event Radio. We really appreciate it.
All right, thank you guys for the coverage.
All right, we'll be right back, guys. All right, guys, we are back from the vintage flat track races, Lebanon, Tennessee. The gentleman we're going to introduce you to was one half of the best race, the best heat races that we have seen since we have been here. What is your name, sir?
Denny Williams.
Denny, where are you from, friend?
I'm from Murfreesboro, Tennessee.
Well, that's not very far. That's
no,
just sort
close.
Of south and turn left, right?
Yes, sir.
When I first met you, you was a Hoosier, wasn't you?
I actually lived in Kentucky. I worked in Indiana.
Henderson, right.
Then I moved down here to get a better job, so... Been down here since 91.
You had to get closer to the country ham and the sweet tea.
There
is that what
go.
It was?
Yeah.
All right. Let me ask you something. You're running a two-stroke bike, and your competitors over here that run so close to you is a four-stroke. Which one's best?
Today in the sand, I'd say that four-cycle works a lot better. You know, a two-stroke's a little harder to hang on to. The sand's so deep, you know, I think you're better off with a tractor than you would be, you know, screaming.
Well, the power band and all that.
Dennis?
I'm sorry. What
are you using
say?
A compression release?
Oh, definitely. Yeah, definitely.
I couldn't tell by the sound of the four stroke.
Yeah. Them things are noisy.
Well, you know where he is that way, right?
That's right.
Yeah. Well, I tell you what, you guys put on the best race of anybody to date. And that's what the fans like. You got to put them on a good show, you know. Everybody says, well, if we do this, if this was this, and if this was this. But what it boils down to, when you put on a show like you two guys did, that's what puts people in the stands.
That's what we like to see, too.
Well, yeah, and that's what you want to see when you're watching
that's
it,
right.
You know. And so many racers don't think of that. They say, well, if the track promoter would just pay more money, or if they would just do this, or if this was this. Well, guess what, guys? You put on the show, then he can play more money.
Shoot, I'd pay him to do this, too.
Yeah, it's fun, huh? So what do you do, sir?
I work at a hospital. You know, motorcycles, hospitals, they kind of go together.
Yeah, you're sort of, you know, a doctor or something? Or
No, nowhere close. No, I take care of the doctors and nurses. I'm the parts guy.
Oh, okay.
Everything from like a Band-Aid to an eyeball. You know.
Well, maybe the last time I seen Dennis, I'm sure he remembers. But Denny was, I think, in Illinois, and you fell off and broke a collarbone on that 360 Bull Taco.
Yeah, I've done that
once. Well, yeah. How many years ago was that? I mean, the person you remember that was there with Charlton and Beasley.
That would be 73 is when that would have been, 73. Granite City, Illinois. I mean.
Granite City, okay.
Yep.
Now, I want to know more about supplying these body parts. Is that, I presume you are kidding. Yeah, are you not?
Joking. Yeah, I'm more into the hard parts, you know, the supplies that the doctors and nurses need to take care of the patients, really, is what I do.
Oh, so you just make sure they got everything on hand and that kind of stuff?
Yeah.
Well, hey, you got a very important job, my friend.
I love it. Yeah, doctors and nurses like me, too. So
as long as you're not bringing your own parts to you.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. What they figure, they keep running around and say, the motorcycle racer, he must be on the organ donor list. Is that what?
I hope not.
No,
that's where
no.
You got that huge following, didn't he?
Yeah. There you go. Well, I tell you what, my friend, you can tell by watching you, this is not your first lap around that track.
No, I've done it for a while. So
how long have you been
racing? Rode my first race in 71. My dad used to take me to races, and we'd sit there and watch. I was only like 15 years old, and he'd say, son, don't you think you're ever going to do this? And that just made me want to do it that much more.
So it was not an encouraging thing for you to do it.
When he found out I was racing, I thought I was going to get the belt. But whenever he found out I was going, he said, well, son, where are you going to go tomorrow? And he used the excuse to make sure I got home safe. And
oh, is that what it was?
He was my biggest supporter all those years.
Well, that's good. You know, that's the way it usually is, really, you know.
Family deal.
And I can remember him in the van with you, and I think your sister was along.
Yep, whole family.
How long ago has that been, really? I mean, wow.
That was in the 70s, but she used to go. Yeah, yep.
Yeah, it's just... Well, this is fun, and I think it's a little bit addictive, you know.
No doubt, guys
we've talked to, and of course, we kidded Charlie Southgate that he actually made the first lap around Noah's Ark when the water went away. But you know.
Charlie invented dirt track. Me and Chris Boone, we refined it.
Yeah, there you go.
Hey, that's good.
Yeah, that's a good way to put that. That's a good way to put it. Because you guys flat put on a show now. Well, there's no doubt about it. You remember how many times you swapped leads? Because you were doing it just about every other lap there for a while.
Oh, Chris passed me, and I was just trying to hang on to him. My tongue was hanging out there towards the end. He's got quite a few years on me. You know,
people say age is just a number, but when you get our age, that's a darn lie.
Let me ask you something. How much physical conditioning does flat track motorcycle racing take?
Well, on a track like this, it's everything, you know, because the track's so deep, you know, hard to ride, you know. But you get on a smoother racetrack with longer straightaways, you know,
get a straightaway, get breath in.
Yeah. Here you're just constantly moving around, you know, so it kind of wears you out pretty quick.
Is there such a thing as a line to go through there?
Oh, definitely. Yeah. You don't want to get too far off that line either, you know. So it's all about, you know, holding that line, getting a good start, you know, not making any mistakes, you know. That's what racing's all about.
Guy with the less mistakes wins, huh?
That's right.
Yeah, that's cool.
You going to get him in the final, Denny?
Oh, we're going to go for it, you know, if I can hold him off. You know, like
y'all
said, my tongue will be hanging out after about five laps.
You're in the money class, so y'all be a little more serious, I imagine.
Might be. I don't know.
Well, that's sort of the, you know, the what's the deal? The cubic dollars gets everybody's attention? Is that it? Or?
Oh, I don't know. I think old age and treachery can beat out youth.
There you go. I love that, buddy. I love that. You know, I talked to a guy. We did a show where there were some guys that are big boy drag racers, okay? I mean, we're talking about Roush and those guys. And we did a show there, and I'm talking to Don Bowles' son. Well, Terry used to race motorcycles. I used to run alcohol funny cars back years ago. Cool. And his son comes up and said, oh, I remember you. I watched you race, and I was sitting there on the ground playing with my truck. I said, buddy, you know how to make a guy feel really good. You know, I mean, I didn't realize I was that old, but he makes me feel like I'm that old. But you know, racing's a funny thing. Once you get bit by the bug, you're just going to sort of hang in there.
Oh, it's worse than drugs, really. You know?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
You just can't give it up.
Listen, my friend, we know you got to. You're never supposed to disturb a man when he's got a spark plug wrench in his hand, and you did have. So,
that's right.
So we better let you go back there and work and sit down and rest a few minutes for the finals.
I appreciate you asking me here, and I want to thank all the spectators for coming out today, too. We appreciate you guys being here.
Well, we appreciate you all putting on such a good show.
Thank you. That's what's really important.
Thank you, Danny. Congratulations on still riding, buddy.
You did good. There you go. Guys, we're having just too much fun. You're on Event Radio. Do not go anywhere. We will be right back. All right, guys, we're back from the vintage flat track racing in Lebanon, Tennessee. And it's a shame we got to drive 100 miles to talk to a guy we talk on Facebook all the time. Tell everybody who you are, sir.
Steve Weaver from Mount Juliet.
Mount Juliet, Tennessee.
Formerly from Bowling Green.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I know. Mm-hmm. Did you slip and fall down that far? What happened?
Well, I just got so old I couldn't remember the way back.
Is that what it was?
Yeah. That happens to all of us, Steve.
Do we need to get you a new GPS? That GPS we got, she keeps saying, I don't know where we're going, you know.
It'll turn you in the middle of a cotton field, too.
Of course, now you rode a motorcycle or two in your day.
One or two, yeah.
Yeah,
What was your first one, Steve?
Cushman scooter.
Ruh-roh.
When I was 14 years old.
I think Spivvy had one of them.
Yeah.
No, you know, I never did. I always wanted one. But a couple of friends had a Cushman, and I, to this day, I'd still like to have one. I think they're cool.
What was that you had? Was that the Harley?
No, I had I had an Allstate.
Allstate, okay.
Oh, yeah. Then I moved up to Harley Sprint.
Had one of them. I had one of them.
Yeah, I had the C model. I think T used to race one of those.
Well, that was Spivvy's that I raced.
Okay. And then went to service and went out to Kansas and got on the Hodaka just because I knew the dealer out there. And then when I went overseas, Lord, it was Bull Tacos, Osas, just, you know, whatever was available.
Exotic bikes to us back then, wasn't it?
Yeah, the guys across the pond beat to a little bit of a different drum, don't they?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they absolutely do. But it's like me and Charlie was talking about something come up, and when he was talking about the Hillside Raceway back in the 60s, the motocross bikes, well, motocross hadn't even started over here yet.
Yeah,
no, everyone run scrambles then.
That's it. It was called scrambles, yeah.
And some of them were TTs with a jump in the middle, like a flat track, but it had jumps and stuff like that. I mean, that shows how crazy the Americans are, right?
Tourist trophies, what the TT stands for.
Yeah, yeah. Now, T may remember because he probably rode it.
Are you saying he's an antique?
He just may remember.
I'm finished. Yeah, I remember.
I don't remember if they had a jump or not. I remember it was back in the woods, but I don't remember if it had a jump or not.
I don't know, buddy.
I don't remember either.
Yeah.
That's a shame when you can't remember what a track had.
Well, yeah, that's right. Well, good Lord, how many of them have you
seen?
Well,
this is true.
Yeah,
that's,
you know.
That's part of what it is, too.
Yeah, you fall down on a few, and then you tend to remember them, right?
I think this event here would have probably, just my opinion, would have probably went over better if it had been better advertised.
Well, we talked about that yesterday in Bowling Green at their new motorsports park thing.
Okay.
They had a track day there, and they had a ton of motorcycles, but it's sort of like kissing your sister. It might be the best year it was, but nobody knew it, you know?
That's it, yeah.
And it's a shame that people that have these things, if you want people to attend, guys, you got to let them know what's going on.
They had
over
140 bikes there, riders practicing.
See, we understand from talking to a guy when we got here, there was one of these in Gallatin yesterday, but I don't have any idea who put it on.
The one Jim Masters put it on, Steve.
Okay.
But see, they got to tell people, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, if you want to get butts in the seats, you got to let them know that it's going on.
That fellow I was talking to said, well, if you'll give me your name and address, said, I'll see that you get a flyer. And I said, well, I don't have nothing to write on. He said, take this magic marker and just write it on that white table.
That's exactly right.
I'm exposed to the world.
Now we're going to expose you to even more.
That's right.
I mean, we're good at this.
Steve, you're like Spivvy now. We both had a lot, or all three of us had a lot of motorbikes. Which is your favorite?
Oh, I don't
depends
know.
Depends on the time in life, I guess.
Yeah, it depends on there in later years. Well, later years, just a few years ago, when I slowed down considerably, an XR 200R Honda or a 250R was hard to beat.
That's what they're running the Mad Dog class today, I think.
Just it, and they're bulletproof.
You know, I like them old XL 250s. You remember them?
Yep, sure.
Boy, I tell you what, I ran one of them one time in a race called the Hungry Creek 100.
Okay.
And ran with a good buddy that we've had on the show that I had no business being out there with, Danny Young.
Oh, Danny's cousin of mine.
Yeah, I know.
The dude and
Lizard.
What really upset me, I'm out there riding my heart out. You know what I mean? I mean, I'm thinking, boy, you're doing good. And it was 4 25-mile laps in Red Bowling Springs, Tennessee. Well, I come around to start my last lap. Danny's taking his stuff off, you know. And I'm sitting there thinking, yeah, how bad are you, you know?
Yeah.
But Danny was just a wizard.
Well, Danny
could
break him sucking eggs any day he wanted to. He's by far probably the best motorcycle rider to ever come out of Bowling Green.
Well, of course, we remember, and a lot of people don't even know what we're talking about, when Danny rode with the Penton guys in the ISDE.
60s,
yeah. Of course. Well, actually, on our archive page is a whole one-hour show with Danny. And we went through the whole history of starting as a kid and working for Bill Hazel and looking at books and asking Bill what the ISDT was.
Uh-huh.
And he said, one of these days I'm going to do that, you know.
Yeah.
And then, of course, he went and on the podium three times in 3 years.
Yeah.
It gets no better than him. But, you having fun down here today?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Didn't expect it to be this warm, but that's just that much better.
Well, I left the house with a long-sleeve sweatshirt on, and my wife said, you better take a T-shirt. I said, no, I won't need that. See, that proves why she's smarter than me.
Well, that's it. I've got a hoodie, but it's in the truck. And, but anyway, looks like the main's fixing to start.
Yeah, I guess we better get off here and go up there and get us a good seat,
well,
place to watch. You
good
know,
talk to you guys.
Hey, buddy, Steve, really appreciate it.
Thank you for taking a minute to be on Event Radio.
No,
it is our pleasure.
Thanks a lot.
And we have a lot of fun jabbering on Facebook. So, you know, guys, this is a cool place. You never know who you're going to see and who you're going to get to talk to, but it's always fun. You're on Event Radio. Do not go anywhere. We'll be right back. All right, guys, we're back. T-Bone, we watched the finals then. That was actually a really, really good race between
Chris Boone and Denny Williams.
Yeah, the two guys we had on the show wound up being first and second. Swap leads about three times, and that's the way to do it. That puts on a decent show, you know, for the people.
Well, you can tell that by the crowds, baby.
Yeah, they all cheering, and I like the Chris Boone guy on the victory lap doing a wheelie in front of the checkered flag all the way down the front straightaway.
He's
that
good
was pretty
to
cool.
Do that.
Well, there's several guys down here that were good riders, you know, that did good and put on a good show for the fans. That's the main thing, guys. That's what you got to do.
Well, about every rider down here that was out there is better than the ones watching. I mean,
boy,
they're giving her a shot.
Yeah.
And what about all the neat old bikes, that twin engine Triumph? And
oh man,
the Norton Speedway bike and
stuff. Yeah, it's worth a trip down here, guys, just to see the vintage stuff. You know, watching the racing is just icing on the cake. But to watch the to get to ride through here and see the vintage motorcycles, the stuff that
and the vintage riders like Jim Masters and Charlie Southgate.
Oh,
I mean,
yeah, and talk about history and stuff. Boy, they got it.
Don't you know they could tell some good stories?
Yeah, well, there was probably several that they were going to tell us, and we sort of elected not to let them because that was a little more than we wanted to know.
Even at their age, the statute of limitations probably hadn't run out
there
on
was
some of them.
A little more than we really wanted to know on some of them. But we've had a blast
a great show every year.
Yeah, we've had a blast down here for Scooter at the Vintage Flat Track Races in Lebanon, Tennessee. I have no idea what we're going to do next. We're going to try to talk to some individuals, like one-on-one, and bring you some people and introduce them to you that you can find out a little about their story and who they are and what they do.
Put the personal touch to it.
Yeah, put the personal touch. But we'll have a lot of fun with it. We appreciate, as always, you taking the time to listen to our shows. We actually try pretty hard to bring you some good entertainment and give you an hour or so of fun. But
Hit us up on Facebook.
Yeah.
T-Guy or Event Radio or Spivvy Williams. Tell us what you want to hear, and we'll try to get it done.
Yeah, right now you got to sort of use our personal page because the Event Radio Live page has got a hiccup somewhere. I figured out why we weren't getting our money. That Ebola thing has cost us all the money because that prince from over in Zimbabwe that screwed up our Facebook page was going to send us all that money, and he never did send it, so Ebola must have got him.
Yeah,
you think?
That's what I heard.
Yeah, that's what I heard. Guys, thank you so much, as always, for listening to Event Radio. As always, we never end our show without thanking our sponsors. They are most important to us. The guys at Beach Bend Park and Splash Lagoon, Beach Bend Raceway.
Good people at Quick Fuel, Final Finish.
the great guys at Gearhead Gazette. Everything you want to know that's going on in the car hobby, go to gearheadgazette.com. It's sure not any problem to find something to go to and have some fun. Last but not least, the great guys at Holley. If you can't find something for your hot rod at Holley, boy, you're not really trying.
Well, you don't really have a hot rod.
Nah, they got so many different companies, boy. You got to find something. Earls and Hooker Headers, and the list goes on and on. Edelbrock and Lenotti, and boy, I lose track. But there's a lot of them, and just go to Holley.com, and you can see what all of them are. As always, we try really hard to put you together a pretty good show. If you like it, please help us out and tell a friend about us. But if you don't, just keep it to yourself. T, let's ride down the road. What do you say?
Let's get in the Griswold wagon and be gone.
We're out of here, guys. Thank you for joining us. We will talk to you again.
Thank you.
You've been listening to Event Radio, covering local drag racing, stock car racing, motorcycles, go-karts. If it's got wheels and you can race it, you heard about it here. Event Radio is motorsports radio on steroids. Join us next time with your hosts, Spivy Williams and Terrible T-Guy.